And welcome, folks, to another edition of RSF Radio. I'm your host, Joe Monday, and today is December 21st, 2017. Getting close to the end of the year. I just want to start right at the top of the show. At the beginning of the show, we recorded a little bit of light spoiler warning for Star Wars: The Last Jedi. So, if you want to avoid some light spoilers, again, light spoilers for Star Wars: The Last Jedi, skip ahead to it looks like it's at minute 2:50. If you skip to 2:15, then it should be all good. All right, going in 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, there's actually no spoiler warning for Star Wars: The Last Jedi. I just didn't have a bit planned for like the beginning of the show. So I'm just going to start into the bullshit of whatever the first couple things are, and then they'll join us at like 2 or so minutes in, and then, I don't know, talk about some fucking porks or something. Anyway, if you're not used to the show, this is a podcast where we talk about everything that happens going on at our Street Fighter over the course of the week, and there's been a lot of stuff. There's been a lot of talk about tiers and tier lists this week, but I want to talk about the only tier list that matters, which is this Beard Tech tier list. Clearly, you can see the Zangiefs are up here in the corner where they rightly belong. That Ryu is pretty good. I like that Zangief. I would like that Zangief with the gray beard to be higher. I think that, when you take that hood off too, that's just extra top tier. He needs to be way at the top. All three Zangiefs, in my opinion. But this Rashid down here. Oh, no. That's no... Hold on. And that's why I thought Porg's just ruined the series. It's just... And when they made that Porg a Jedi, that was fucked up. That's a little fucked up that they made that Porg that Jedi. It said some weird shit about Greedo, too, so I was not okay with that. But anyway, folks. Moving on to the next bit. Someone actually just shared this post the other day, and I thought this is a really good encouragement for new players who might be coming to the series. If you're coming in with AE, dude basically tells a story. I don't know the gender. Anyway, dude tells their story that they went from rookie to platinum in 9 months. They even set a goal of getting to gold by the end of the year, and they not only met that goal, but exceeded it. And they list out kind of the steps that they took to go from absolute rookie to platinum player in 9 months. It takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of effort. And I think that it's revealing to have that documented in that way, to give players maybe an idea of what is expected of you if you want to get to that next level. Because it doesn't really take that little bit of... you don't need to be the best player execution-wise right off the bat. You don't need to be that best player execution-wise in 9 months. You can get to platinum. It's not that you need to be gifted. It just takes work. But I found the story really interesting. And if you find yourself in that position of someone who's just picking up Street Fighter V, getting in at AE, then by all means, read through this. Or if you just happen to find yourself in bronze, it's a good outline of what the steps that someone took to get to the next level. So, thought that was pretty interesting. Next bit of... We went from bronze to platinum, and now we're going to extra god tier. God damn it. Anytime that there's a Kuroda video or a Kuroda clip shared on our Street Fighter, it will be featured on this podcast. Like, guaranteed. And this is a situation where Kuroda intentionally gets hit by a crouching medium punch to make the follow-up Tatsu whiff so that he can punish, and then he later goes on to win the round. Kuroda's the best. If anyone tries to tell you that Kuroda's not the best, then they don't know what to talk about. He's the best. Like, very clearly the best. Period. With every character, not just, like, one character. Reading into the comments there, too, because there's some... a little bit of backstory of this whole set, where they were in the set. Shares a link to the full set if you're interested. Regardless, watch Kuroda play. If you're interested in Third Strike at all, just search Kuroda and then a character name, and then if you want to see some very high level play of any character. But that's just my opinion. Okay. And I wanted to share this. This actually got posted, I actually don't know when it was originally posted. I'll hit the link for that, but on Wednesday, I believe, or early Wednesday. Maybe it was Tuesday. Regardless of when it was posted, this is an interview with Street Fighter II creator Akira Nishitani. Plus, you get Harada in there talking game. And it is, bar none, the best interview. It is the best fighting game related interview of the year, period. If you are at all interested in, like, how, you know, if you want some inside baseball, if you want to know how the sausage is made, this interview is, it has these two guys spitting game at each other, and it's like, it is as if the interview just disappears from it entirely. He asks a couple questions, but at the same time, it's these two highly intelligent guys speaking very intelligently about the games that they've created and how those views have changed over time, but not really, and just having such reverence for old games. I actually picked out a couple quotes, just a couple to share, to give you an idea. And this is only from, like, the top half of the interview. There's some more gold later on in the bottom half, too. So there's, it's a long one, so, like, stick with it. But just picked out a couple gold ones here from Nishitani, explicitly, because he's the Street Fighter guy. Harada's the creator, but the dev from Tekken, basically. And Nishitani says, and he quotes, "I'll do anything to make this game fun." Speaking on what the development team was like, what their feelings were when creating Street Fighter 2. Or this other quote of, "If you only think about the specifics, your interpretation of the game will just match what's convenient for you." Like, wrap your mind around that and think about what he's talking about there. Like, man, like, I just love to be in a room. I would love to have been in this room with these two talking and understanding their language, but that's another issue. Now this quote, "Don't simply think about how you want to go. Actually play out the entire situation in your head. It's rare to be able to match your original vision 100%, but it's important to share and refine ideas first and worry about specifics later." And my favorite quote, from the top half of the interview, "Samurai Showdown was a pioneer of fighting games themselves. Full stop." That was included by me. "It's not just the properties of the game were different. The entire nature of the game was different." It's how you're talking about power slashes and how that gave so much character to the characters of that game. And I don't know if this is known. I've talked about this before in the past, but I think that maybe Samurai Showdown 2 is perhaps my favorite game, fighting game of all time. Perhaps. It probably is. And to look at these two guys speak so intelligently on that franchise is, to me, very heartwarming. And I cannot recommend you read through this one enough. I promise you, it is the best interview, fighting game related interview you will read all year. I promise you that. Moving on from that, though, on to the next topic of, here's some other interesting stuff that you can read up on and watch up on if you watch the CPT, if you watch Capcom Cup. One of the best memes to come out of that is Nammo offering that Stan Hard Punch handshake to Itazon. And what this, what 121 Gigawatts did was he broke down the entire rivalry between Nammo and Itazon. And he goes match by match. If you want to, this is like some Street Fighter investigative reporting here, and it is pretty complete, I would say. Or if you just want to watch some cool Zangief Urian matches, I mean, if that's what you're into, I would recommend doing that. It's a friendly rivalry, but it's a rivalry nonetheless. And what's more exciting in sports than friendly rivalries? Nothing. So if you saw that moment and thought there's probably history there with that smug AF handshake, what's that about? Read up on it. It's interesting. The lore is good here, folks. I promise. All right. And speaking of the other kind of sports reporting, which I love, is garbage statistics about sports. It's like, it's one of my, I love it. I love it because it's terrible. And what, I'll reel it back now. So what the Coding Human did, in the title of this post, I looked at Namo's matches versus Punk and Problem X. Yurian's V-Trigger did 40% health on average, and 11 out of 12 Aegis's led to a win. Which is, like, the biggest... That line is, like, the numbers that commentators pull out of their asses when they need to fill time. Or, like, in the playoffs, you know, the team that scores the goal first is... You know, they have a 75% chance winning. That's like some Scott. They do some Scott Steiner math here, and I love me some percent chance of winning. Oh, it's so good. But like, there's spreadsheets here, and it makes me smile, and I love it, and I also find it ridiculous and super not useful, like at all. Like any of those sports numbers that any commentator says is just, it's like a complete bullshit number. It's like when you go to a casino and the roulette is the other percent chance thing that is a like hilarious ruse, is at a roulette table when they have that board there and it shows all the numbers that hit, which has no bearing on what numbers will actually hit next. If you know anything about statistics. I always call it statistics because I had a professor who called it statistics, and I thought it was funny every time he said it. But anyway, if you're interested in this hilarious sports maths, this quick moths, check out this thread. It was kind of great in like a guilty pleasure way. All right, now some actual matches. This one from NEC. I feel like people forgot about NEC. Like, I know we just had Capcom Cup and people are super excited about the Pro Tour, but there are huge tournaments outside of the Pro Tour that are still happening. There's KIT, I think, is coming up. Oh, shit, is it this week or next weekend? I'll have to check the calendar. It wasn't on FGC Cal, and I told him about it, that he needed to add it to it, but I don't know if he added it to it or not. Regardless, that's coming up. So, like, mark your count. Like, there are still big events happening. But NEC happened. And this is a great set from IDOM and Jug. So, if you want to watch some very high-level Bison play in response to some very, you know, top-level Laura play, maybe you play Bison, you want to know how to avoid the mix-up, you want to get out of the grind, Jug's got you back. So, watch through that one for this highlight reel of a match. All right. Next one, also kind of a highlight reel. I think I'll always share these when they come up on the sub, but it's the MAGA that I can get behind. The Make Alex Great Again compilations, part 21. So there's a lot of it. If you just want to see Alex do some... Oh, man. I love it. It's so good. If you want to see Alex steamroll some fools, because he's very good at burst damage. He can do burst damage when he's conditioned his opponent enough and can... get things done. When he's got the resources for it, when he's got V-Trigger, when he's got full critical art, he's capable of burst damage. And that can be very exciting to watch, because otherwise he's a fairly limited character. But when you can steal his turn back and do some hyperbob bullshit, it's some good stuff and it's very entertaining. And I will almost always share these clips. So look for the link down below in the comments section and give this video some love. Give Alex some love. Hopefully Capcom will. Alright. Anyway, moving on. I love this next bit. Because it's something that is not... I don't know, it's information that is not really made apparent to newer players, not really made apparent to people who have a limited set of people that they can play. People might have like a limited mindset of what it means to get better as a player. But Brian F. Posted this video, and it is of his match against Infiltration in the losers finals of the Last Chance qualifier. So this was a while back, a little bit ago. If you didn't know what happened, Infiltration won and then faced off against Nemo in grand finals of this of the Last Chance qualifier. But Brian F. takes a hard loss here, and he's playing Balrog, and Infiltration picked Minot. If you're just doing the maths on this, if you're doing the math, everyone will say that Balrog dunks Minot. It's free. Actually, like a lot of Zangief players will pick up quick secondary pocket Balrog for this particular matchup. But what is evident here, and Brian F. talks about this, is that he's never practiced the matchup. He's played maybe one or two solid Minots in at all, and right now he's playing one of the best Minots, and a very strong player in general. Someone who probably knows this matchup because it's one of Minot's bad matchups. And just because someone says your character will dunk a character does not mean that you can go in just swinging. You can't just go in swinging for the fences and think, oh, I can win. And Brian talks about that. And he breaks down the decisions that he makes and the mindset of what you might be thinking of when you know in your head and people tell you, and it's in your head, that this is a good matchup for your character. You should win every time. And it will break you in some ways. But also, in addition to that, Brian F. always does a great job of breaking down his matches, things that he does wrong, things that he can work on. And if you're looking for an exemplar player, if you're looking to model your own... that's the word I'm looking for. If you're looking to model your own, you know, the way that you look at the game, if you're looking for someone to model that after, look at Brian F. Dude's humble. Dude knows what he's talking about, and is capable of recognizing when he's made a mistake, and then capable of going to fix that mistake. So, give that man some love. Alright, next topic. Alright, moving on from that, talking about replays, the next topic to talk about is, what's your favorite comeback in Street Fighter history? I think this question is great. It's a great question. Because it will always lead to people sharing hype videos. To me, in my mind, I think there's one right answer here. And I think it involves Snake Eyes. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then look through the comments section of this particular thread. Or if you just want to check it, like, that's the best thing about this thread, that you're guaranteed to watch some hype reels happen, because comebacks are exciting. When someone's down and against the ropes, to watch someone come back, a little less exciting in Street Fighter V, whenever, you know, it's instances where a V-trigger comeback can be expected, and you can't kill unless you have critical R, you can't chip out. But that's beside the point. That's all beside the point. That's no matter. There's some Street Fighter V in here, in this thread. There's some Third Strike. There's some Street Fighter II. We got all that stuff. It's all here in this thread. Or if you think that all of these people are wrong, fuck them. Post your own video. Let them know what you think is the best comeback in Street Fighter history. Just in general, a fun. It's just a fun thread. So dig through that one if you're looking for some exciting Street Fighter matches throughout history. All right, moving on. Speaking of blasts from the past, I want to bring up this thread because it just reminded me that this thing existed, and I want to share it with people because you should all know that it exists. If you're at all interested in Street Fighter 4 and you're at all interested in playing Makoto, I almost said Minot there, and then my brain stopped for a second. Which these are two diametrically opposed characters. But anyway, someone asked the question on the subreddit. This is Banbarrel. What software was used to compile the Rendouken Bible? And I bring this up because the Rendokan Bible is fantastic. It is a great resource. It's somewhat out of date because it was based on AE 2012 and there was a version change to Ultra. Regardless, a lot of that information doesn't necessarily change all that much. But it is a clean guide and it looks fresh. That's why they asked. But also super useful, full of good information. If you're at all interested in playing Makoto or interested in what an awesome guide might want to look like, if you're interested in putting together a guide, in fact, because that question is answered and document properties say it was designed Adobe InDesign CS6 for Macs. So that, I mean, that's like the answer to the overall question. But really what I want to talk about is, yo, the Rendokan Bible is fantastic. It's just a fantastic resource in general. But this is reminding me of that. I'm going to bring that one up because I love good tutorials. Oh, snap. This one failed. SRK, please. So the next thing I want to talk about, also a tutorial, was from Frabasaur. He basically runs down and explains. This is also shared in SRK, so we'll give the guy some love because he's been putting up a bunch of tutorial videos and how-tos, helping people get from rookie to bronze to silver, all that good stuff. But what he breaks down here is explaining how to break out of autopilot. And it's something that I think a lot of players can fall into the trap of, especially in Street Fighter V, because there are techniques that if you just do them, you shut your brain off, you can win. It will grant you wins, but it will not make you a better player. He brings up a lot of topics on how to prevent that from happening, and if you think that this might be you, check this out. If you say, no way is that me, this also might be you, you might want to check this out. If you are looking critically at the way that you play and watching your opponent, then good on you. Because those are two major factors on maybe avoiding autopilot. I think there's a Geef's Gym that kind of says how... there's actually a Geef's Gym on how to build an autopilot. Basically build the flowchart, but also part of that is breaking the flowchart, but that's another issue. That's another story. Two not so different things. This one's fun. I think I've shared this dude's videos before, but the philosopher, FGC philosophy with the philosopher. He gives an interview and interviews Automatic, talking about how to learn Zeku and in general how Automatic goes about learning fighting games. And it's very interesting to see his perspective. I agree with a lot of what Automatic says. I typically agree with a lot of what Automatic has said and recorded in video in the past. It just brings up some fun topics about, you know, you can't just teach someone how to play, you gotta make it interesting. Which, you know, sorry for being so dry, folks. I apologize for that. That one's on me. Sorry these videos are... No, that's just me projecting. But no, it's a good interview. It's half hour long. I recommend checking that one out. Again, all these links will be shared in the comments section, regardless of where you're watching it from. And I thought I skipped ads. I had to turn on ad blocker when I do this. Don't buy IKEA. Specifically, don't go buy an IKEA. All right. Anyway, next topic. We're going to move into the Arcade Edition segment of this podcast, where the rest of these topics are based off Arcade Edition, because it's coming, folks. A lot of information's out there. So just want to give some love to Born Free. He went through with a lot of the top players who are out there spending time looking at the latest build of AE, or at least the one that was at PlayStation Experience in Anaheim, and he goes through and breaks down what Akuma's second V-Trigger... Alright, so let me reel this back a little bit. What are we calling them? Are we calling them V-Trigger 2 or second V-Trigger? Look, what's the nomenclature on this? Because I gotta... Because V-Trigger 2 sounds bad. Like, that... It just doesn't flow. It's not... doesn't have that good sound. The timbre is off a little bit on the tongue. Saying that it's a little bit staccato there with the two that I don't like so much, but that's not important. What's important here is that he shares his opinions and the opinions of the people who were there basically testing all the stuff. I think, I don't know if he names all of them, but I think Alex Myers was there. Brentis Cool was there doing all this stuff and running through how to do this Akuma stuff. And he goes through and breaks down like what might change in the past, what Akuma is capable of with the second V-Trigger. So if you're interested in specifically the Akuma changes and perhaps what's to come with your character, check out this video. Alright, and the next Arcade Edition bit of information is kind of big news dropped last week, which we'll get into in a little bit, some other news that dropped about this game. But last week, they announced the changes in how you will earn fight money, which has a couple people up in arms. It was like ridiculous, right? Because they have all this goodwill from AE. They're saying, we're going to make all these changes. We got so many new things coming. We're going to roll out announcements. Time to feel good. And that's great. And everyone's feeling good. And then they go ahead and say, yeah, let's point this gun at these boots. I was told they're steel toe. I should be fine. My man. Like, the thing is, all right, so I'm giving some Capcom some shit about this, but I get the math on this, right? Because if you do buy Arcade Edition, right, and you get all of Season 1 and Season 2 characters, there's a lot of, well, currently in the game, there's a lot of available fight money for all of those characters that you can get without touching any of the online content. Like, you can get through the story modes, the demonstrations, which are just, like, 2-second things you just AAA through because they're garbage. You do the trials. You do easy and normal survival mode. Those are bearable, I would say. Those are doable within a certain time limit, I would say. They're not that crazy. You could do the character story mode, and you could do the main big story mode for quite a bit of fight money, and they're gonna release more and more characters, and you're gonna get all Season 1 and Season 2. So if you were to get AE and have all of those characters and be capable of earning all of that fight money up front, you could easily pay for all of Season 3, all of Season 4, and maybe even Season 5 if you combine all that fight money with just buying AE as it is, you know? Because, you know, you're doing the math of all of Season 1, all of Season 2 characters in addition to the regular cast, and then you add in Season 3 characters, and then just that number grows exponentially, especially if you're only starting from the base game of AE. So in that, it makes sense. What that also means is that if you want to be using fight money to buy all those characters, I think it's actually like the cheapest to buy. This is just an aside, because we're going to get into it later about buyer's guides for AE. But if you want to, I think I haven't done the exact math, but in my head, here's how it works out: is that if you can find Street Fighter V, a Season 1 and Season 2 pass for lower than or equal to $40. You buy that right now, and then spend all of the time in between now and January 16th earning all of the fight money that you can from all of those characters. Some of that will be difficult for brand new players. If you're coming to things brand new, there are some trials there that will give you trouble, which will prevent you from earning some of that fight money. But there is a lot of low-hanging fruit. Survival easy mode is very easy. And all of those things will gain you points for free. And also, the other thing to note is that, and this is kind of just going back to the announcement here, is that they're taking that stuff away of just earning the base points for like story mode and training and all that stuff, or the trials. But they're not taking away the fight money from when you gain character levels. That will still be there, which is included in some math that I'm going to talk about later. But if you buy Street Fighter V as is, Season 1, Season 2, Character Pass, get all the fight money that you can in between now and January 16th, then that will pretty much set you up for the cheapest way to earn the following characters for, like, Season... You'll be pretty good for Season 3 and 4, depending on, you know, how fight money is doled out in Season 3. They kind of talk about it here, how you can... Like, here's the kicker. Remember a couple episodes back where I joked about, wouldn't it be funny if they released loot boxes for Street Fighter V? Because fuck everything, fuck the world, 2017. It's actually the subtitle for 2017. FTW. Then they go and release, like, effectively gambling of you put up your money up front and you could earn it back. It probably won't be hard to earn it back and gain the actual earnable fight money. That probably won't be hard. And, like, in my heart of hearts, I feel like that's not going to be difficult. However, it is sort of putting your fight money on the table for them to potentially take it away, which is just, you know, in 2017, in the current zeitgeist of people pushing back against gambling in video games, you go and release some gambling in your video game. Street Fighter V, please. Ugh, Capcom, I love you. I love you in the way that I love a puppy that finds its tail and then when it bites it goes, ow, that hurts. Just, come on, man. It's cute. It's very cute. But if you're looking for all of the breakdown of what the new fight money structure will be like, check out this post and dig into the Capcom Unity blog post by Strumslinger. It's fairly informative. So if you want to get the full breakdown, go there. The other thing that was announced just the other day was... was Team Battle for Arcade Edition. Keep in mind, this is a local play only. So if you have the game local, you can build out your team. Basically, King of Fighters style, where you select your characters. You can select what carries over, like, will this character carry meter over to the next fight? Will the opponent carry over V-trigger? That's also a super weird thing. It's kind of funky, but what's fun about this is that this announcement was released by Up Up Down Down, which is the channel run by Xavier Woods. So this is, you know, square inside the Venn diagram of people who are fans of the FGC and wrestling. It's basically one circle right there, and they play into that big time, and that's great. I love those guys. It's very entertaining to watch the entirety of the stream. Give Xavier Woods a follow, of course. Give Up Up Down Down a follow. Check out his streams. Check out his videos. It's all good stuff. But then he got this cool announcement of something that is, I don't know, it's a fun addition to the game that we didn't necessarily knew that we were going to get. But it's cool that Capcom trusted this group of six wrestlers of, hey, do you guys want to talk about a game that's not released yet? And probably, like, don't break any information here that we're not letting out yet. So just, you know, keep that on lock. People that we don't really know that are used to just saying what's on their mind. I don't know. That's fun. And it's a fun stream. And it's cool that we're getting this other new feature with AE that we didn't know before. Hopefully there's some more stuff, some more announcements before January 16th. I expect. I mean, it's been how long has it been since Capcom? Two weeks? It's hard to remember days when you're an idiot like me. But I don't know. Maybe look for some information next week or the following, in 2 weeks from now. Look for more announcements, I would say. They are releasing them at a pretty good clip. Whoever their hype architect is doing a pretty good job, but also a pretty good job of killing the hype. But that's not here nor there. This is pretty cool. And can potentially lead to some fun tournament situations if, you know, there's certain team tournament pool or whatever. It's, you want to have fun with your friends. That's also an option. But the last topic concerning AE, if you somehow are listening to this podcast and have yet to buy Street Fighter V. You just, if someone suggested to listen to this podcast or something to fall asleep to, and that's why you're listening, hello and welcome. This is a podcast where we talk about Street Fighter and the happenings thereof, news thereof. But this post breaks down. It's a arcade edition buyer's guide. I know I talked about it a little bit earlier since that change in fight money, but this breaks down what you get when you buy a version of the game, where you buy it, are you pre-ordering it, and are you planning on getting Season 3 Character Pass? It's kind of all of the potential situations. Like, what if you already own Street Fighter V? What do you do? What do you get? Because it's a free update. It's all that. It's just, it's questions that we've seen asked on the sub. Even still, there's a question like, how do I buy? How do I pre-order if I'm on Steam? And it's like, you don't. We still get that question every day. But regardless, this post is here. It's going to be, I think we might keep this one stickied until AE drops, because it seems to be a pretty common question between everybody. And that's just, it clears up the sub whenever we have posts like this, big main post right at the top. So that is, if you are interested in buying Street Fighter V and you're interested in what is happening with Arcade Edition and you want, like, what do I have to buy, this post breaks down pretty much everything. There's even a full-on fight money breakdown of what the current situation is, which will change. So if you want to look at how much fight money you can earn if you just buy the current set as it is, and you go through all those characters, how much fight money you earn, how much fight money will be left over, I kind of get into all of that. And you can also glean, I didn't do the math on this, but you can also kind of glean from it, you know, how many character levels you'll gain by doing all this stuff in Arcade Edition, which will then, like, give you some amount of fight money. I'm doing a bad job of explaining it verbally because it's math and I can't speak numbers to y'all. I can't speak numbers. I just can't do that. I don't speak math. It's another thing. It's another language. But regardless, folks, if you find yourself asking, how do I buy Arcade Edition? This post will do the trick. All right, and this is usually the segment where we go into user questions, but we're not going to do that. Instead of going into user questions, I'm going to ask you guys a question. Because I want to talk about this next week. I want to go into a great deal with this. End of the year is coming. And next week is going to be the last Thursday of the year. So sad, on the 28th. Oh, hey. That's my anniversary. I better plan to record on another day. Thinking out loud. Write that one down in my mind palace. Okay. But the question is, and the question I'm thinking, it's the end of the year, coming to a close. You see a lot of gaming sites say, you know, what are your top 10 games of the year? We're going to build a list of top 10 matches, top 10 sets from the year. There's a ton of great tournaments to choose from. If you want some places to look, like, look at the CPT schedule, look at the schedule that was built from, look at the calendar from FGC Cal that's listed on the sub. All that stuff. There's ways to find these tournaments. Remember, you know, all the matches that you've seen from over the course of 2017. It's been a pretty good year in terms of competition and what's been going on. Lots of exciting matches. But my question to you, and I'm going to make a post about this on the sub, and I'll link to it here, is, what were your favorite matches? You don't have to list 10. Just, you know, give a handful. Like, what stood out to you? Do you want to grab some stuff from the most recent Capcom Cup? Or you want to dig back from January earlier this year? You know, shit, I'm like, what? Like, it's, dates are hard for me, but I can still, like, remember matches that have happened that I'm going to talk about next week. But that is my question to you, and I'm interested to see and what all of you end up posting. And I also encourage you to post matches that are personal, because I feel like that is a, it is in my opinion, that Street Fighter is at its best when you have, and watching someone play Street Fighter is at its best when you have an emotional attachment to that player, an emotional attachment gained by time, gained by camaraderie, there is no better feeling when you're watching a friend play and they just dunk somebody that you know is a skilled player. That, because there's some shared victory there. You didn't win. It wasn't you that did it, but you were there in the building of that player, and there's a certain, it is hard to explain if you've never been in that position, but some of those moments from this year, for me personally, have been the highlights of the year for me, as I actually might need to track down those particular videos if they exist. But I'm going to post a link to a thread where you can post your favorite videos of the year, and we're going to talk about them on next week's show. Unless there's any like other huge Street Fighter news, what happens between now and next Thursday, which could happen. There could be another big like Capcom Unity blog post that either blows AE up or makes it look amazing. It's a roll of the dice at this point, folks. I like gamble. But look for that link in the comments section below on whatever if you're watching the YouTube video or if you're looking in the details of whatever you use to listen to podcasts, be it iTunes or whatever, or the Red Fed. But neither here nor there, let's get into the last section. I've been thinking about Street Fighter 4 a lot lately, and the last section that we always roll into is FGC history. We know Capcom Cup. It was a big tournament that just happened, big series that happened. People loved the big production value. One of the first big production values for Street Fighter in general was actually put on by ESGN TV. And by hearing that name, some of you might know what I'm already talking about. But this particular set, and I kind of just bring up like this whole season in particular because it was just like a fun setup. But look at these graphics. If you ever want, I'll share the link below so if you may follow along. This shit looks like ESPN. Look at all the future looking stage and setup they have, and the fake jumbotron. It's kind of incredible the production value put on for Street Fighter at this time. And it's also hilarious and soured because the first thing that they do is show this. Look at this cardigan wearing motherfucker. Like, brought out by these. They pay the booth babes to dress up like schoolgirls and walk out this cardigan ass motherfucker. They have this whole, like, Sports Center looking intro, and then cut to welcome to the FGC, and I remember seeing that for the first time and just basically yelling at the screen of like, seriously, you guys, like, we're gonna open with this, the first shot pan up to that. It is, man, that's just how the FGC's been for years. But anyway, the match in particular that I want to share with you guys, the setup of it is they spun a big wheel and you had to win in a first to seven between a random opponent out of a pool of opponents. And the match is Cien versus Mike Ross, Gen versus E Honda. And I particularly want to bring this one up because some of my favorite stuff about Street Fighter, again, is when you're playing against friends and you specifically tell your friend that you're going to do something. And you warn them, do not do this thing, because I will fuck you up. Specifically when you tell them that. And then you do it. And there is a moment in this match where I think Cien tells Mike Ross specifically, do not whiff an Ochio throw after headbutt here to gain extra meter. If I have super, because I will punish you. And he does it. And you see the look on Mike Ross' face when he looks over at him and he goes, you told me you didn't do that. That one's on me. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful moment. I love it. But the whole set's, it's a fun set. And the whole feeling on the set of the stage is fun. I kind of like, there's it's one of those things where you can get a lot of that, I think, in 2017, and it's good to look back on moments like this. You see on the stage, there's all eight of those guys on the couch basically giving each other hell, and it's fun. It's a good set. There's a dog on stage. That's good. Dogs are good. I forgot about the dog. Fuck, what a good set. Anyway, folks, that about wraps it up for this episode of RSF Radio. Again, this is the podcast where we talk about everything that's been going on in the week of our Street Fighter. But I'm your host, Joe Monday, and you can find me on Twitter at Super Joe Monday, or find me on the subreddit at user Joe underscore Monday. Hit me up anytime if you have any questions. Look for all the posts that I've talked about in this podcast, link below in the comments of whatever you used to listen to. And if you're listening to it on iTunes, I was told to tell you guys to rate and review it on iTunes. And in the other podcast thing of telling people, I don't care what you review it. Apparently that's a thing you're supposed to say, so I'll say it. But that wraps it up. Catch us every Thursday with another episode of RSF Radio. But until then, folks, take care.